times made in Bible study, in sermons, in just Bible classes in general, can be that we move too quickly from text to application. We read a passage and immediately we want to know how to apply it to our everyday lives. And it is indeed good that we read Scripture with the desire to apply it to our lives and to change our lives according to Scripture. So the desire for application isn't the problem, but the problem can be a premature move toward application. One principle of Bible study and interpretation that will help avoid premature and misguided application of Scripture is that before we can apply a passage to our modern lives, we need to know what it meant to the original audiences. Part of this is addressed by identifying the context of the passage in Scripture. To whom was the passage first addressed? What were their problems? What were their needs? What were the questions that the passage is trying to meet and answer? A good example of interpreting and applying a passage without identifying the original context or identifying the original audience or the original intent is in the parable of the sower in Matthew chapter 13. In a few minutes, we're going to take a closer look at this parable, and we'll also look at some of the other parables in Matthew chapter 13. Excuse me. We'll look at the primary lesson of the parable of the sower, but we'll also look at how the parable of the sower introduces the other parables that follow in the rest of the chapter. We'll be going very quickly at times to cover all the parables in chapter 13 of Matthew. We can't spend much time on either, so hang on, and I hope it'll still be clear, even though we'll be going somewhat rapidly. For the next few weeks, I'll be preaching a series of lessons drawn from the parables of Jesus. Matthew 13 just happens to be the first major collection of parables in the New Testament, so that seemed to be a good place to start. We certainly won't look at all of the parables that we have from Jesus, but we'll look at several of them. And I'll try to group them into groups that deal with a similar theme. That's what we'll be doing this morning in Matthew chapter 13. To introduce the series, though, let's just get some general information about the parables out of the way as we start. Parables are just basically stories that Jesus presented to accomplish various goals. It is impossible to say that all parables had the same purpose, or even that they fit the same rules of interpretation. Bible students don't even agree on what qualifies as a parable. For example, some scholars say that the parable of the sower in Matthew chapter 13 is the first parable in the book of Matthew. Others will cite as many as 11 parables before chapter 13 in Matthew. Some students consider a simple analogy to be a parable, such as you are the salt of the earth. For others, a parable has to be a more fully developed story. My opinion is, for what little that's worth, is that the story of the wise and foolish builders at the end of the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 7 is the first and only true parable in Matthew prior to the parable of the sower. The use that Jesus made of parables is also quite varied. For one thing, Jesus sometimes taught with parables, but not always. I've heard it said that preachers today should use storytelling as their primary form of preaching, since that's what Jesus did. That statement is fundamentally false because it's built on a false premise. Jesus used parables sometimes, but most of his teaching was not done through parables. In that most famous sermon, the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapters 5, 6, and 7, he didn't tell a single real parable until the very conclusion with the story of the wise and foolish builders. Let's also point out that the stories that Jesus told are drawn from life, but not from his own life. I don't think we have any examples of Jesus using stories from his childhood or from family vacations or from cute things that their family pets did. Now, that doesn't mean that preachers today can never tell that kind of stories, but not using the stories of Jesus as the precedent for them. Unlike most of the stories that we tell in sermons today, the stories of Jesus were not always told to make the lesson easier to understand. In fact, we will see in Matthew chapter 13 that these parables were told specifically to keep most of the audience from understanding. If not easier to understand, parables serve as word pictures that make teachings easier to remember or to give the teaching more emphasis. And sometimes Jesus used parables to make sure that certain people could not miss the message of the parable. He did that particularly late in his ministry when he wanted to make sure that the Pharisees understood that he was indeed talking about them. So a great variety of uses can be found in the parables of Jesus. The parable of the sower is a major parable in the ministry of Jesus. It's one of the few parables that is recorded in all three of the synoptic gospels, that is Matthew, Mark, and Luke. I believe it is also the only parable that the name we use for it, parable of the sower, is in fact the name that Jesus himself gave to it. And the fact that Jesus gave us the name, or a name for this parable, might be a clue as to the true meaning, or at least to the primary purpose and message of this parable. It's also the parable for which Jesus most clearly said that the purpose for giving this teaching in parable form was to keep most of his hearers from understanding what he was saying. So here's the sequence. Jesus told the parable of the sower. No one clearly understood what it meant. The close disciples then came to Jesus and asked why he was teaching in obscure parables. And he answered that what he was saying wasn't meant for everyone to understand. And then he went on to explain the parable of the sower for the benefit of the disciples. After the explanation of the parable of the sower, Matthew then records the parable of the wheat and the weeds. This is followed by two short parables about mustard seed and leaven. After those two little parables, Matthew then says that Jesus dismissed the multitude and explained the parable of the weeds to the disciples, much like he had explained the parable of the sower to the disciples. And the fact that only the close disciples received the explanation is also an indication that will help us understand just what the parable of the wheat and weeds meant. The primary application that we often make of the parable of the sower is as an admonishment to the hearers of a lesson that they should make sure that they are good soil and receptive to that message. I read an article recently from a very solid gospel preacher who made that application. He wrote, "It is clear that the emphasis of the teaching is on the quality of the soil rather than the faithfulness or skill of the sower." I don't think it's that clear at all. In fact, I don't think that's a correct statement. If the purpose was to get the crowd to evaluate what kind of soil they were, why did Jesus make sure that the crowd of all people couldn't understand what he was saying with the parable? Now, I'm not saying that no one should ever evaluate their personal receptivity to the gospel. And I'm not even saying that we can't use the parable of the sower to teach that. I am saying that if we make that the main purpose of the parable, we will miss the main purpose of the parable. The main purpose was something that the close disciples needed to hear, And it wasn't that they needed to evaluate the reception of their hearts to the teachings of Jesus. One of the hardest things that the close disciples faced during the ministry of Jesus was to understand the nature of the kingdom that Jesus was going to establish. They expected an earthly kingdom. They expected a kingdom where they would be close to the center of power. And they expected that when Jesus set up the kingdom, nearly every Jew in Palestine would flock to be in it, which made it all the more important for them to have locked up the key positions in advance. Three chapters earlier, Matthew chapter 10, most of that chapter is Jesus explaining to the disciples the amount of persecution and opposition that his followers would face in his kingdom. We also know that all by itself, Matthew chapter 10 did not cure all of their misconceptions. As one more step in helping them understand the true nature of the kingdom, Jesus spoke the parables of Matthew chapter 13. The parable of the sower introduced the lesson that was spoken to many but explained to very few. This was basically the message of the parable of the sower. He's saying, you need to understand that not everyone is going to get on this bandwagon. Some people won't pay any attention at all. What you preach after I am gone will in some cases disappear like birds eating seed. Don't be surprised and don't be discouraged when that happens. Others will look very receptive initially, but they won't last. Some will burn out very quickly. Some may hang on for a while until the distractions of life crowd out their immature faith. Again, don't let that get you down. Don't let it get you down, because some will listen. Some will respond. And they will grow into a fruit of the Spirit like nothing you would have ever imagined. More than anything else, Jesus was preparing the disciples for preaching the gospel to the entire world, to all kinds of soils, where they would not know in advance which hearers would respond favorably and which ones would not. He didn't want them to get discouraged when the reception to the kingdom message wasn't as positive as they expected it to be. The primary application for us today is the same. We are expected to take the gospel to the entire world and to present it to all kinds of soils, because we don't know in advance which individuals will respond favorably and which ones won't. And we shouldn't get discouraged to the point of quitting when we sow the seed and the response isn't exciting. The parable of the sower then sets the direction for the rest of the parables in the chapter. Jesus followed the parable of the sower with the parable of the wheat and the weeds. In Matthew chapter 13, I want to read verses 24 through 30. Another parable he put forth to them, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. And while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the grain had sprouted and produced a crop, then the tares also appeared. So the servants of the owner came and said to him, 'Sir, did you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have tares?' He said to them, 'An enemy has done this.' The servant said to him, 'Do you want us then to go and gather them up?' But he said, 'No, lest while you gather up the tares, you also uproot the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest, and at the time of harvest I will say to the reapers, first gather together the tares and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn.' He explains this second parable a few verses later, beginning in verse 36, going down through 43. The problem here is similar to the problem addressed in the parable of the sower, but it's slightly different. Now the question wasn't about soils that didn't produce anything, but seed that produced bad stuff. What about, they would say, the other religions and the false doctrines that would spring up after we have preached the good news of the kingdom? The answer was basically, don't worry about it. That's the way it is in the world, and I will take care of such things in judgment, Jesus said. That didn't mean that the disciples should not oppose false doctrines or correct ungodly behavior. But other than preaching the gospel, the job of purifying the world of evil wasn't their job. The parable of the dragnet, much later down around beginning in verse 47, presents much the same idea. Now, some Bible students use this parable to claim that even in the church today, all rebuke and all discipline is to be avoided and left for God in judgment. But if that's the case, even after Jesus explained it to the disciples didn't understand, nor did they practice it. Because the disciples clearly expected Christians to live holy lives, and they taught the churches to hold members accountable for godly living. Remember, this was spoken before anyone but Jesus had any concept of the church. This was about what happens in the world when disciples of Christ are scattered out through the world. As with the parable of the sower, this would have answered a question of the disciples about the nature of the kingdom when Jesus would no longer be with them in the flesh. The parables of the mustard seed and the leaven also help the disciples to understand some realities of the kingdom. They're given in verses 31, 2, and 3. The disciples didn't fully understand the nature of the kingdom and had some unrealistic expectations of how things would go. On the day of Pentecost, Acts chapter 2, there was a pretty exciting positive initial response to the gospel and to the kingdom. And to some extent, that continued for a while, but we know that it didn't continue indefinitely. And even at the very beginning, major portions of the population, especially the Jewish population, were opposed to the teachings about Christ. The preaching of Christ and the preaching about Christ later did not produce a massive, overwhelming, immediate conversion of the great majority of the Jewish people, not to mention Gentiles. The parables of the mustard seed and the leaven taught that the kingdom would have a relatively small start. The kingdom would have humble beginnings, but it would grow and it would thrive. But the disciples should not be discouraged by the initial smallness of the kingdom, because this little seed or this small lump of dough would eventually spread throughout the world. After the explanation of the parable of the wheat and the weeds, Matthew records two more short parables, verses 44 through 46. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like the treasure hidden, in a field, which a man found and hid, and for joy over it he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking beautiful pearls, who, when he had found the one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it. First, we have the parable of the hidden treasure, followed by the pearl of great price. In totally different terms, Jesus had taught the same general message back in Matthew 10. As I said earlier, in Matthew chapter 10, Jesus gave an extended warning about the persecution and the opposition that his followers would someday face. In that speech, he encouraged the disciples not to let the cost of following him keep them from following him. Among other examples that Jesus gave in Matthew chapter 10 was the opposition of family. The lesson was that as severe as it sounded, following Jesus was more important than anything else, including physical family relationships. In Matthew 10:37, he says, "He who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and he who loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me." In the two parables of Matthew 13, verses 44 through 46, the one, the hidden treasure and the pearl of great price, he is reinforcing that same idea that he presented in chapter 10. When the disciples would later take the gospel to the world, they would be tempted at times to think that what they suffered for the kingdom wasn't worth the cost. By these two parables, Jesus was saying that it definitely was worth the cost. Even before they went to the whole world, they would be challenged to question the cost. Imagine early disciples in the city of Jerusalem when Stephen was stoned to death for doing nothing other than preaching Christ. It would have been natural to wonder just how dearly they were willing to pay. A little later, when Herod killed the apostle James in Acts chapter 12, again the question would pop into their minds. And they could remember that little story that Jesus told about the man who sold everything he had so that he could buy that pearl. So what are the proper applications of these parables for our lives today? First of all, we should recognize and honor the original application of them. Jesus was concerned that his disciples would be disillusioned if things didn't play out as they expected. He spent a great deal, not just Matthew 13, he spent a great deal of time in his ministry preparing the disciples to face reality. Much of what he told them didn't sink in at the time. But later, when the kingdom became reality, they remembered things Jesus said, and sometimes they remembered it because it was summarized in a nice little story. Part of those memories were, of course, aided by the Holy Spirit. But instead of just remembering that Jesus had said there would be persecution, or instead of just remembering that there would be people who weren't interested and they should keep on preaching anyway, they would also be able to picture that imaginary man throwing seed out on the soil and only some of it would produce. They would understand that some people were like hard soil, and some people let the distractions of life crowd out their faith. And they should not be surprised by those things, nor should they be overly discouraged, because they had been warned of that. In short, I believe that the parables of Matthew chapter 13 are addressed first of all to sowers, not to soils. Jesus wanted those who sow the seed of his kingdom to know what to expect. And he didn't want them or us today to be discouraged and to quit sowing because of the discouragement. For just one example, we currently have over 60 World Bible School students signed up on the internet just from the Johnson County area to study the Bible over the internet. But only 5 of them are active, and active means that they have shown some activity over the last 30 days. Our teachers could get discouraged and quit adopting more students. Or they can remember that Jesus had said that it would be like that, but we are to keep on sowing. There are also then the secondary applications. I don't want to imply that because they're secondary, they're not important and not usable. If someone we know has heard the gospel but has not accepted the gospel, it is not twisting scripture to read the parable of the sower to him and ask him to identify what kind of soil he is. It's not twisting or distorting scripture, because it is true that there are different kinds of soil and only one kind pleases God. We should be motivated that no sacrifice is too great and no cost is too high for sharing the gospel. But since the kingdom is of greater value than life itself, we can use the pearl of great price story to help someone accept the gospel, even if it causes other earthly problems for them. Truth remains truth, and it can have sometimes more than one application. Let me give a hypothetical example using the Apostle Paul. We cannot know if Paul consciously thought of the parable of the hidden treasure when he was facing persecution and opposition. But in Philippians chapter 3, he itemized several things that he had given up for the gospel and for his ministry. And then he wrote Philippians 3 verses 8 and 9. "Yes, indeed, I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in Him, not having my own righteousness which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God in faith." That is consistent with the thought and with the application that Jesus intended by those parables of the treasure and the pearl. But then, when Paul would write, let's say, to the Thessalonians, as we're studying at the 9:30 hour, he could write to the Thessalonian Christians as they faced opposition, and he could use the same parable to encourage them simply to remain faithful. He could tell the parable and then say, whatever your place in the kingdom cost, it's worth the price. If we are encouraged by the story as we sow the seed, then people we teach can be encouraged by the same story as they are contemplating accepting the gospel. When the close disciples of Jesus thought of the kingdom, they had an idealized physical kingdom in mind. It was a kingdom where they would be important and they would enjoy all the perks of physical kingdom power. Jesus could have had more followers than he did if he had encouraged that kind of thinking. And after all, before they figured out the truth, he would be safely in heaven. But instead of that, Jesus wanted his followers to expect tough challenges and be ready to face them with great faith. The apostles continued with the same level of honesty and integrity in their preaching. They promised blessings. They promised eternal life. But like Jesus, they also taught the cost of commitment, and we must do the same. Lord willing, next Sunday we'll be looking at parables about the cost of discipleship. Jesus died for our sins. He gave up His life on earth to give us life in heaven. There are advantages on earth that come with following Christ, but the main advantage is forgiveness of sins and eternal life in heaven. Nothing on earth is worth more than that. Believe in Jesus. Believe in His sacrifice for your sins. Believe in His promise that life in heaven will be better than any life on earth. Turn from sin. Be baptized in the name of Jesus, and He will give you a new life that leads to heaven. If you want to respond to the gospel this morning, let us know. Let's stand and sing.